Does anybody see a candle lighter here? No?
No, that is one, it's back here.
Okay.
They would have, it would have come back here because they would have taken the light from there, walked out, and then went out and then went back here.
So, but no, Edna needs to know where it is.
Okay, it's gonna be over, well.
We should just put it up here somewhere, shouldn't we?
You want it up there?
Yeah.
All right, Gary will have to come up to here to get the light.
Thank you. Thank you. That was wonderful. Thank you, guys. I invite you to stand with me for the call to worship. We'll read this responsibly. It's printed in your bulletin. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth.
Sing to the Lord and bless God's name. Tell the good news of salvation from day to day.
Declare God's glory among the nations, God's marvelous works among all the peoples.
For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised.
Let the heavens be glad, and let the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar, and all that fills it.
The world and those who live in it.
Let the whole creation sing for joy at the presence of God, who is coming.
God is coming indeed to judge the earth with righteousness and the people with equity and truth.
Praise the Lord. We come to you in joy, O God, and we pray that you will come to us. Be in our midst, fill our hearts, and by your Spirit enable us to worship you this night with great love and wonder. Open us to the possibility of being changed, conformed to the pattern of your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. And I want to welcome you tonight to our Christmas Eve worship. Here, as we draw close to midnight on Christmas Eve, here at Community United Church of Christ, the place where no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are always welcome. I do want to point out a couple of things. We're having communion tonight, and when we do that, you're going to come forward to the chancel, and Gary and I will hand out the elements. And there will be, I think Etta will be guiding you coming from the back to the front. So we don't want any trampling and, you know, broken bones or anything like that. Also, at the end of the service, we'll be passing the light as we sing Silent Night. And you should have got a candle. Hold it up if you got a candle. Yay! And I will get the light started. Please remember, don't tilt lit candles. If you have the lit candle, hold it straight and let the other person tilt the candle. We will try to minimize the amount of wax that spills on our rug and everything. One other note, we have a grief support group here at Community UCC that meets two Tuesdays a month. And it's due to meet this Tuesday, the day after Christmas. And I just want to let you know, yes, we are meeting. So if you are dealing with grief of any kind, and you feel the need to share that in confidence with a group of people who are going through the same thing and care, 7 o'clock on Tuesday night, we will be meeting here in our library at the church. So that's something that's coming up. Let me check and see what's going on now. Okay, I'd like the chains to come up and light the Christ candle and the other candles.
Hope is assertive, peace is subversive, joy is provocative, and love is transformative. God tore open the heavens as hope became alive in us with the cry of the newborn babe.
Holy Child, bring us hope.
The heavenly host, the army of God, showed up and instead of declaring war, said, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace, goodwill to all."
Holy Child of Bethlehem, endow us with peace.
Joy was shared by parents and visitors in the midst of an imperial census and under the rule of an insecure puppet king.
Holy Child of Bethlehem, fill us with joy.
And love from God, love from one another, the Christ Child taught us that the greatest love is to lay down one's lives for one another, to set aside the things of this world that would tear us apart, and instead look to what draws us together. This is the kind of love that still transforms the world when we share it.
Holy Child of Bethlehem, transform us with love.
On this night, we light the Christ candle, a reminder that hope, peace, joy, and love are not merely words for this season of the year, but promises of God that are alive in us for eternity, and that God's steadfast love endures forever.
Amen.
The first lesson tonight is from the book of Genesis, chapter 3, verses 8 through 15, and then 17 to 19. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" he said. "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself. Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me fruit from the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is it that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent tricked me, and I ate." The Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you among all animals, and among all wild creatures. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will strike your head, and you will strike his heel." And to the man he said, "Because you have listened to the voice of your wife, you have eaten of the tree about which I commanded you. You shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. In toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your face you shall eat bread until you return to the ground. For out of you were taken. You are dust, and to dust you shall return.
The second lesson
is from Genesis 22, 15 to 18. The angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time from heaven and said, "By myself I have sworn, says the Lord, because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will indeed bless you, and I will make your offspring as numerous as the stars of heaven and as the sand that is on the seashore. And your offspring shall possess the gate of their enemies, and by your offspring shall all the nations of the earth gain blessing for themselves, because you have obeyed my voice."
Before Beth reads the next lesson, I want to invite the kids to come on up. We didn't have it in the bulletin because I didn't know we were going to have children here tonight. So, come on up. How are you doing? Okay. We're back here with these people. We've been looking at this for the last 4 weeks. What do we see? Joseph and Mary, the cradle. We see, who's this? Angels and shepherds and donkey. He's making waffles. Little Shrek reference there, I like. And we got the wise men over here and a cow. What's missing? Baby Jesus. Huh. The reason that there's no baby Jesus in the manger is because we've been celebrating Advent the last 4 weeks. And Advent is a time of expectation and waiting. And now the waiting for the baby Jesus is over. And so, pick a hand. Okay, you want to put the baby Jesus in the manger? There you go. Now the scene is complete. We have Jesus who has come as a baby. And what we need to remember is that Jesus grew up. Jesus grew up to become a man who taught us how to live and then who taught us how to die by dying for our sins and freeing us from evil. And so when we come at Christmas to adore the baby Jesus, we need to remember that there's a grown-up Jesus that we also need to worship and follow. And so let's pray together. Gracious God, we thank you for your love for us. We thank you for Jesus and the way that he has come to our lives and shown us how to live. Help us to follow with full hearts and great faith. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks, girls.
The third lesson today comes from us from Isaiah 9, verses 2, and then also again verses 6 through 7. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it, and with justice and with righteousness, from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this.
As we come to our time of prayer, let us engage in a few moments of silence as we center ourselves and focus on the God who comes to us in Christmas. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, on this holy night you gave us your Son, the Lord of the universe wrapped in swaddling clothes, the Savior of all lying in a manger. On this holy night, draw us into the mystery of your love. Join our voices with the heavenly host that we may sing your glory on high. Give us a place among the shepherds that we may find the one for whom we have waited, Jesus Christ, your Word made flesh. On this holy night in which God joins heaven and earth, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all those in need. Let us pray for the church around the world as it celebrates the birth of Christ. Bless all those who are entrusted with Christian ministry, that they might proclaim your word with truth and courage across our world. Bestow your wisdom on all who govern, that in honoring the earth and its diverse races, cultures, and religions, we may celebrate the light of this holy night. Grant reconciliation to those surrounded with conflict and violence, especially those living in the birthplace of Jesus Christ, a holy land on a night that is far from silent. Still, O God, the noise of guns and bombs and the wailing of the dying and the bereaved. Bring justice and peace to Israel and Palestine, that all may live in the peace of this holy night. Let us pray for all who are cold, hungry, or alone this night. Embrace with your tender care, O God, all who wander alone or have no place to lay their head, that they may experience the hope of this holy night. Let us pray for all who are anxious, depressed, or ill. Draw near to those who find this season a source of pain or grief, and to all who are suffering or sick, especially those we remember now in the silence of our own hearts. That they may feel the comfort of this holy night. Let us pray for parents, families, and newborn infants. Strengthen families in the bonds of love and commitment, that they may delight in the joy of this holy night. Let us pray for ourselves and for the blessings of Christmas. Open our hearts to your presence, that we may be transformed by new birth on this holy night. Let us give thanks for all the faithful departed who have been bearers of the Word made flesh. Give us grace to follow your holy ones in lives of faith and commitment, that we may join with the hosts of heaven in singing the praises on this holy night. All these things, and whatever else you see that we need, grant us, O God, for the sake of him who died and rose again, who now lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The fourth lesson comes from Isaiah 11, 1 through 4a, and then picking up again 6 through 9. A shoot shall come out of the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counseling and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see, or decide by what his ears hear, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. The wolf shall live with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid, the calf and the lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw with like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the asp, and the weaned child shall put its hand on the adder's den. They will not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea.
The fifth lesson is from the book of Luke, chapter 1, verses 26 to 38. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord of God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren, for nothing will be impossible with God. Then Mary said, "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her.
The sixth lesson is from Luke 2, 1 through 7. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who he was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them at the inn.
Lesson comes from Luke 2, 8 to 16. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger.
Thank you.
was going to let you sit through that one anyway, but you're dedicated. You stood up. I have a confession to make. This is church, right? So, okay. I have a love-hate relationship with Christmas. I love Christmas itself, but I kind of hate the Christmas season. At least advertisers and the Madison Avenue has made the Christmas season into. More specifically, I hate the mawkish sentimentality and crass commercialism that typify this season of the year in our culture. I hate that we have consented to advertisers turning the wonderful holiday of Thanksgiving into Black Friday Eve, and their unsubtle hints that if we just buy the right stuff and decorate our houses the right way and go to the right parties, we will somehow achieve happiness. We will find enduring love. We will discover peace within. We will experience joy. But even when we put the big bow on the Lexus in the driveway, even when we put so many garish lights on our houses that they are visible to astronauts on the International Space Station, even when we run ourselves to a frazzle attending every holiday-themed event that comes along, even when we do everything right, the way it's depicted in all 837 of those Hallmark Christmas movies that have the same plot, we still find that sense of peace missing. The joy still elusive. The so-called magic of Christmas always lets us down. And we have even been brainwashed into blaming ourselves for not having enough holiday spirit. Next year, we'll get it right. Next year, we will find our own version of happily ever after. Perhaps the saddest development of all this is that when we finally get to Christmas Eve, we are so worn out from shopping, wrapping presents, decorating, baking, attending concerts and cantatas and kids' plays, cleaning our houses so they look presentable for all the company that's coming. Why on earth did we invite all this company to our house? By that time, we are so depleted and disgruntled that we barely have time for Christ. And even when we do acknowledge Christ, we too easily fall into the trap of sentimentalizing his birth. We conjure up a bucolic scene like this one over here, with a thatched roof hut and open fields dotted with cotton ball sheep, a bunch of friendly beasts, a trio of kings following a wandering star to bring treasures to an infant that has such an angelic face and disposition, the little Lord Jesus, no crying he makes, that you could swear he was loaned out by the Gerber Baby Food Company. Everything is perfect in these imaginary scenes. The straw in the manger is never scratchy. Mary's labor and delivery are painless. All the bathrobes and towels worn by the shepherds are clean and downy fresh. And no barnyard smells befoul this barnyard tableau. The heavenly beings that appear to the shepherds are not scary creatures, but adorable little imps with diaphanous wings straight out of a Precious Moments catalog. The outside world intrudes not at all, unless we consider the hard-hearted innkeeper who turned away this desperate couple in their hour of need. Fortunately for them, the farm animals were more accommodating. Sentimentality, that's what we're looking for in a Christmas movie or a nativity scene. We're looking for iconic figures perfectly gracing an idealized Christmas card depiction of the birth of the Christ child. And the reason that we are able, year after year, to maintain the necessary level of sentimentality is because we don't read the rest of the story. We don't let the child grow up. But the child does grow up. He grows up to become a firebrand preacher and healer who consistently steps over the line as far as the religious authorities are concerned. He relativizes the laws of Sabbath. He presumes to offer forgiveness outside the temple system. He welcomes undesirables to eat at his table with him, thereby calling into question the whole social hierarchies that the people use to make sense of their place in the world. He challenges patriarchy by accepting women as disciples and also by demanding equality, not subservience, not chattel status, to wives. When he gets to Jerusalem, he mocks the governor and severely ticks off the religious authorities by performing prophetic acts of protest right there in the middle of the holy city. No reasonable observer could fail to see that this guy is asking for it. This is not gentle Jesus, meek and mild. This is not the patient child smiling beatifically as the kid pounds away on his toy drum kit, ba-rum-pa-pum-pum, while he and his parents are just trying to catch a few hours of sleep after a long and trying day. This is not the sad-eyed, mopey Jesus from the paintings and the movie depictions. This is a tough-minded yet compassionate crusader for justice with a calculated program for advancing the commonwealth of God through agitation and direct action. This is a strong figure who courts controversy if it will serve the cause of God. This is the one who, in the words of Simeon, is destined for the falling and rising of many in Israel and to be a sign that will be opposed, and whose fate will be a sword in his own mother's soul. When we sentimentalize Christmas, we miss out on the fullness of the challenge Jesus brought to the people of his time. And maybe that's why so many people find it so easy to dismiss Jesus as a relevant figure in our time. We have trapped him in a moment as the holy infant, so tender and mild, like an insect encased in amber, beautiful, safe, and irrelevant. And what a disservice that does to a man who altered the course of history and launched a movement that, for all its faults, after 2,000 years, still has the capacity to give people ultimate meaning and to inspire them to revolutionary action. It's hard to imagine right now, but we're really relatively close to our annual consideration of Jesus' suffering, death, and resurrection during Lent. Ash Wednesday is just over a month and a half from now, and Holy Week will follow only 6 weeks after that. It will be here before we know it. So, in that spirit, I invite you to join me in a foray into the realm of imagination. Consider, if you will, a manger made of wood, and the child of a poor out-of-town couple, the child wrapped in cloths and laid in said manger on a cold night because there was no other appropriate place for him and his parents to stay. Imagine also that you live in a country that is not covered with great tracts of forest land, where wood is at a premium, and so it gets reused over and over and over again. Imagine that somebody pries a plank of wood from that manger and starts using it for some other purpose. Then imagine this process repeating. Imagine this plank of wood making its way north over the years until finally a fisherman scavenges it for use to patch his fishing boat on the Sea of Galilee. Then it makes its way south again and ends up at Herod's palace, the headquarters of the prefect, Pontius Pilate, when he is in town. And this plank of wood is in pretty rough shape by now. Its unplaned edges are a breeding ground for splinters, and its surface is wormed all over by nail holes. Some of the nails, hopelessly twisted and rusted, stick out in various places. Now, imagine a young man who runs afoul of the law during the Passover festival about 30 years after being the child lying in that manger. He gets convicted of blasphemy and sedition and sentenced to be crucified. While one of the Roman soldiers on duty whips him with a Roman scourge, another goes looking for a piece of wood to use as a crossbar for the execution. He runs across this old, shabby, ragged plank and lays it on the convict's shoulders, ordering him to carry it to a hill outside Jerusalem where it will be attached to an upright post and used to kill him. The point of this little imagination exercise, of course, is to show that there is a direct connection between the infant holy, infant lowly of the Christmas story and the Man of Sorrows of Good Friday. The crib and the cross are intimately intertwined. You can't have Bethlehem without Calvary. You can't have the adorable baby without the grown-up victim of state terrorism. You can't sentimentalize Christmas and still honor Jesus. His death came as a logical result of the way he lived his life, just as Martin Luther King's did, Oscar Romero's, Mahatma Gandhi, and Dietrich Bonhoeffer. When we come and adore him tonight in his crib, let us remember that the crib and the cross are connected. And let us honor the man just as we honor the baby by the way we live our lives in the world, by the things we say and do, by the choices we make and the choices we refrain from making, by the commitments we hold and the sacrifices we make, by the fruit of the Spirit that grows in our lives, the love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Let us give ourselves wholeheartedly, without reservation, to the child who became a man, who became the Lord of the cosmos. Glory to God in the highest, now and forever. Amen.
The eighth lesson is from the book of Matthew, chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet. And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod secretly called for his wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went to the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
Thank you.
response to the great generosity of God in sending the Son as a little child, and the great generosity of Christ in sacrificing his life for us, let us share generously with the world through our witness, through the work of for justice, and through our giving. Let us remain standing and sing our praise. Glory to God in the highest. Thank you for the gift of Jesus Christ and for the life and hope he brings to us and to all the world. Receive these offerings, we pray, and multiply them for the work of your church and for the growth of your commonwealth on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to God.
Let us give thanks to God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
God of all times and places, we gather at your table of grace to recall your vision of hope for all creation. Through Abraham and Sarah, you revealed your promise in the surprise of a child. Through your prophets, you called your people to make way for peace and justice. In Jesus, you revealed your way of forgiveness and love. Through the ever-circling years, your word discloses to us again and anew your promise to restore all things. And so we join our voices with all your servants in earth and heaven, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. As we gather to share this sign of hope and fulfillment, we remember Jesus, a child born into obscurity amid fear and uncertainty. We remember the fragility of that revelation, as well as the hope he stirred and the imagination he inspired. We remember Jesus, the one who blazed a new and risky path of extravagant generosity and compassion and passionate concern. Temple shaker, world maker, rule breaker, risk taker, the author and finisher of our faith. We remember Jesus' self-giving love and the way he offered himself for others, even those who gave him over to death. On that night, in the midst of great confusion and fear, Jesus broke bread with his friends, saying, "This is my body, which I give for you and for all. Whenever you do this, remember me." With a blessing, he took the cup and offered it to them, saying, "This cup is the blood of God's new covenant with the world. When you drink this, remember me." Mindful of these things, we trust in God's goodness revealed in the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Come to us, life-giving Spirit of God. Bless us, bless these gifts, and bless all we do here, so that our lives might become love songs to your people and your world. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Alleluia! Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the peace. Alleluia.
Gary, if you'll come join me.
Blood of Christ, salvation.
Remember that every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Let us pray together. God of shepherds and kings, you gather us by the light of the star of promise. You lead us not only to hope for the future, but also to trust in your abiding presence in every moment of our lives. Guide us this night by the light of that same star. Lead us to the mangers of the world, where the renewal of life overcomes uncertainty, and love transforms hearts, minds, and souls. Be present with us on this most wondrous of nights, for the sake of Jesus Christ. Amen. Our ninth lesson comes from the Gospel of John, the first chapter. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which light enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us. And we have seen his glory, the glory as of the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. Have seen a great light. Those who lived in deepest night are lit up with brilliant sight. Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. The spread of his influence and of his peace will never end. Go out into the world, therefore, with great love, great joy, and the grace of Bethlehem's matchless child, the love of God who never ceases to amaze, and the fellowship of the Spirit who never wearies, will be with you this holy night and always. Thanks be to God.